Hello and welcome to Aging Matters. My name is Ann Barlet. I'm the Public Advocacy and Outreach Manager for the Berks County Area Agency on Aging.
It's time to break out your...
Sponsored by the Berks County Area Agency on Aging. Our show today is on a topic that is unfortunately not spoken enough about, but is important to know more information. It is on elder abuse. And my guest today is Tina Weiss, and she is the Protective Services Supervisor for the Berks County Area Agency on Aging. Welcome and thanks, Tina, for being here. I know this is not an easy topic for a lot of us to hear and to kind of want to more ignore than know about, but it certainly is very important that we talk about it. And again, in awareness that the month of June is awareness, Elder Abuse Awareness Month. So we're going to delve into that a little bit today. So thanks. First, our first slide to show is kind of the way I wanted to start, because it really is a broad but impactful piece, and it's pretty much elder abuse hurts everyone. And I think that that kind of sets the tone for our program today, because as much as it might be out there, it may also be here without us really knowing it. So I wanted to just start also with kind of talking about a little bit more about we have a few. We didn't want to overwhelm everybody with some statistics, because I think in this case that might help us to kind of get a grasp a little bit more on some of the what's happening. So I'm going to pull up that slide. And this one is elder abuse and its impact and what you should know. So Tina, would you just share a little bit of the statistics, and if you want to share any comments about each one?
Sure. In the United States, there are an estimated 41 million Americans aged 65 years of age and older, and they comprise a rapidly growing portion of our population. It's estimated that in 1 year, 1 in 10, or 10% of Americans who are over the age of 60 experience some form of abuse. And oftentimes, when people are abused, it is not just one type of abuse. It may be physical and emotional abuse. It may be neglect combined with exploitation. We often find that when someone's victimized, they're victimized in multiple ways, unfortunately.
Yes, unfortunately.
In the latest year, the statistics are available, 2009, the annual financial loss by victims of elder financial exploitation was estimated to be $2.9 billion.
And we've come a little bit further than 2009. We're almost 10 years later. And
correct.
So,
unfortunately, the problem continues to grow significantly. And the National Elder Abuse Incidence Study estimates that only 1 in 14 people who are victims of elder abuse ever come to the attention of authorities. So while we know that 1 in 10 people are victimized, the number is most likely much, much greater, unfortunately.
Unfortunately, and so we say they suffer in silence. And in many cases, it's very detrimental directly to their health in some cases.
Correct.
Okay. I would like to then, at this time, and I think we'll add it again at the end of the show, but I would like to have the next slide, which is to show that, please, as we mentioned, that that last slide saying that it doesn't come to the attention of authorities, I'm going to stop right now and share to report elder abuse. Why don't you share how we can do that?
Please contact our office, or the Pennsylvania Department of Aging runs an elder abuse hotline. Both phone numbers are listed. And our agency phone number is 610-478-6500. While our office hours are 8 a.m. to 5 p.m., we do have people available 24 hours a day. If you have concerns about a family member, a friend, a neighbor, someone from your church potentially being the victim of elder abuse, please give us a call and talk to one of our intake workers who can gather the information and talk through the best way to proceed.
Okay, good. Thank you. and while we were on that and why they should call us, and sometimes they think aging, but you may not think 60, 62 is really aging. So again, why should they be calling our agency? I guess that would be my question. Do I call this person, that person? Can you share why we have that Protective Services unit, and then why they should be calling our agency?
Sure. The Area Agency on Aging investigates reported elder abuse, and our job is to look at whether or not there is any type of abuse occurring, and if there is, to work with that older adult to develop a plan to reduce or eliminate the risk that the abuse is presenting to them. We are not law enforcement. We often work hand in hand with law enforcement if a crime has been committed, but we don't. It is not our role to prosecute people or to punish people. Our role is really to look out for the best interest of that older adult who may be suffering some sort of abuse or neglect.
And it wasn't that one day the Area Agency on Aging decided, hey, we should do this. This is a good thing. There is some legal backing of that designation to do.
There is a Pennsylvania state law that tasks the Area Agencies on Aging across the Commonwealth with investigating suspected abuse and neglect.
So in any area within the state of Pennsylvania, should you suspect elder abuse, your call could be to your local Area Agency on Aging.
Correct.
Okay.
Correct.
All righty. Very good. So let's, we use the word abuse, and we need to, I guess, define that, because some images may be in our minds of mostly physical, where we're thinking an elder person, whether we're trying to caregive, whether it's a rough day for everybody. I think we think one thing, but there's a lot of types, and as you said earlier, multiple forms, mm-hmm. which could go hand in hand. So let's start with the different types,
okay.
if you will.
Correct. There is just the overarching abuse, neglect, exploitation, or abandonment. Are the four broad categories.
Okay.
In abuse, mm-hmm. Oftentimes people do think of physical abuse, whether it's somebody being hit or pushed or grabbed, but physical abuse is just one small area of abuse. The person may be the victim of emotional abuse. Someone may be yelling at them, belittling them, isolating them from other people.
Okay.
Kind of the type of abuse that I think people really don't like to think about, especially when it comes to the elderly, is sexual abuse, where people are being mistreated in a sexual way, whether it's an act of rape or sexual assault, or whether it's that the person has really progressed and because of a dementia and isn't able to provide that informed consent for the sexual act that may be occurring with someone. There's also neglect. And, oftentimes we think of caregiver neglect, where either a family member who is in a caregiving role or a paid caregiver isn't doing what the person requires, but there's also self-neglect, which is one of the most commonly reported types of abuse here in the state of Pennsylvania, where the older adult, because of either physical or cognitive impairments, is no longer able to carry out their activities that they need to on a daily basis. Maybe they're forgetting to eat, forgetting to bathe, forgetting to take their medications, not keeping up with medical care.
Kind of the daily things that
we all need to do.
Sometimes.
Right.
Okay.
And certainly we all know people who maybe don't do those things, choose not to do those things, but self-neglect really crosses into another area where the person just doesn't know or isn't able to recall to carry out those activities.
Okay.
We have exploitation. Oftentimes, I know when I got into this field, we used to think of exploitation as being families or caregivers coming into the home or people who befriended and preyed upon people. Increasingly, unfortunately, we're seeing unseen people who are exploiting older adults, through scams, lotteries. Whether they're contacting the senior by mail, by phone, as more and more seniors enter the brave new world of the internet, we're also increasingly seeing people being victimized online, and it's
They get you come anywhere.
Right, I mean, it's anywhere.
They can come up with the technology.
Correct, correct. Any form of communication, really, people are vulnerable to being exploited. And abandonment is the final type of abuse where, you know, an older adult is just abandoned, whether they're abandoned in their home and their caregiver walks out, or, you know, they're dumped off at the emergency room and because the caregiver just can't manage their care anymore.
Okay. There was something I wanted to ask about, and we can delve into each of those examples, but when you were talking about the financial exploitation, and it can come, you know, many times we're seeing the scams, and we'll talk a little bit more about that, but one of the thoughts that came in was, do you see, or maybe prevalence, and it may not be Berks County, but in the state it's prevalent, or vice versa. Anybody who, I have a story in my head where somebody was very concerned that an elder person was being taken advantage of with the potential of financial exploitation because a passerby was frequently visiting an individual or something, and trying to get to become power of attorney, let's say, for that individual, and therefore having been a legal way to do that, been given the opportunity access to that individual's finance, and then being able to think they can do what they want with the money. And we know that's not what the power of attorney is fully for financial. But is that something, is it less prevalent, you know?
I mean, we do see it from time to time, you know, and certainly, you know, if you become aware of a situation where, you know, someone takes a sudden interest in an older adult and you're concerned that potentially they're grooming that person, you know, certainly to talk to the older person and to try to determine what their comfort level is with this, their relationship with this individual. You know, if you know their family members and other people that they trust, to talk through, you know, who is this really the person that would have your best interest in mind? And, you know, certainly if you have more red flags or you're becoming increasingly concerned, you know, to call our office and talk to an intake worker and just process through what your concerns are. And they can help determine whether this is something that our agency needs to look into.
Okay. So I think you touched upon it before we go into some of the more specific examples and then how we recognize. How can I, as an individual, I may have a little bit more knowledge because of working at the Area Agency on Aging, but everybody out there doesn't. And so we want to talk about some tips and ways to recognize or begin to go, oh, as you said, a red flag. But prior to that, so abuse hurts everyone. I'm going back to the beginning. Mm-hmm. So abuse can occur?
Anywhere.
Anywhere.
You know, anywhere that an older person lives, you know, In talking to people in the public and talking about elder abuse, sometimes people automatically assume that we're only talking about abuse that occurs in facilities. And unfortunately, just as often, if not more so, our workers are going in to people's homes in the community where, you know, maybe they live alone, maybe they live with family members or friends, but the abuse or neglect or the alleged abuse or neglect is happening out in the community just as often as it's happening in personal care homes or nursing homes or other types of care facilities.
And I guess I should say, and the person committing that abuse could also be
anybody. You know, again, you know, when you talk about abuse, people tend to think about either paid caregivers or family members. But it could just as easily be a neighbor, a friend, somebody from church, or again, some unknown person who's either preying on the person by mail or phone. You know, occasionally, not very often these days, thankfully, with some of the increased safeguards that have been in place, but people are sometimes exploited by contractors still, you know, or other paid professionals that develop relationships with them over time.
So because there's so many types and examples, and I don't know, I think that I would like to be able to help us to start to think and to how can I recognize abuse? I don't, you know, people are hesitant. I don't want to jump the gun. Maybe it is a normal, natural something or other in the home that's happening. But I'm uneasy as a neighbor. I'm uneasy as a church member or friend whose friend tells me a story. Mm-hmm. So can you tell us, and maybe each of those different types of abuse have maybe their own little things that I can go, oh, red flag, tip. What might some of us recognize that might be some form of abuse?
As far as physical abuse, the signs are pretty obvious oftentimes. Okay. You know, unexplained bruises, changes in the person's appearance, you know, saying they fell, and when you see them walking around, you know, they walk just fine. Emotional abuse. People tend to withdraw. You know, either they isolate themselves, or the person who's emotionally abusing them causes them to become isolated. Changes in personality. Maybe they appear fearful. Maybe their demeanor changes when they're around the person who's being abusive towards them.
I would think that I'm just picturing myself maybe as a neighbor, and we're always outside, out back waving or something, and, you know, I might be saying, well, how are you? I'm just doing my normal conversation. How are you today? I didn't see you yesterday. And I would think that that person may go, oh, fine, and want to scoot back in the house,
right.
Something
and,
like that.
Right. And,
okay.
And that
can be...
That in and of itself isn't necessarily
exactly.
concerning, but if you know, this is someone that who's always engaged with you and been much more friendly and outgoing and, you know, engaged in conversation, and suddenly, you know, there's a shift, especially if there's been a change in their household composition. You know, maybe an adult child's moved back home, or a grandchild, or someone else has moved into the home, and then suddenly there's a big change in the person's behavior, that could be a red flag. You know, especially I think about, you know, neighbors hearing yelling. You know, that we sometimes get calls about that, you know, suddenly people are hearing people yelling at each other in the home. With neglect, you know, does the person's hygiene appear to be lacking? You know, and a change in their hygiene. Again, especially in light of, is there a change in their caregiving situation, maybe the death of a spouse and a child becoming the caregiver, or suddenly there's a change in their appearance. Or over time, you begin to see changes in someone's appearance, especially with self-neglect, where, you know, things slowly maybe decline. Weight loss, unexplained weight loss. You know, maybe you talk to your friend and they mention a health complaint, but they're not going to see their doctor about it. Those sorts of things.
Okay. And then financial, let's talk about that, because you know, there's a couple obviously ways and people, whether it's within family or not, but I think that you can mention that. And then let's talk a little bit about scams, because that seems to be prevalent, and again,
prevalent.
I'm assuming that it's not going away, and it's multiple ways. So, talk a little bit about financial exploitation, then maybe we'll go right into scam.
Financial exploitation. You know, suddenly, again, your acquaintance friend starts talking about concerns about how they're going to pay their bills, or how they're going to get medication, or how they're going to get groceries, and you're not, you know, it doesn't make sense because they've always been able to afford those things before, but suddenly, you know, they're very concerned about how they're going to do those things. Maybe they mention that a child or other family member has suddenly taken over managing their finances, and they're very controlling about how they give them money for things. Some, you know, especially if it's a closer family member, you find out that accounts have the names on accounts have changed, or utilities being shut off. You know, oftentimes one of the first red flags is that someone who has an income that would normally be sufficient has their electric turned off or their water turned off due to non-payment. Things like that are often some of the things that people begin to see and question. Changes in power of attorney, changes in, again, in household composition. You know, oftentimes,
I was going to say, some of these, obviously, although we said earlier with multiple forms of abuse, they many things can be occurring also at the same time. A new person moving in, also seeing some financial piece with that, or other changes.
Or, you know, an adult child, you know, moves back home because of a job loss or other major life event, and is reliant upon the older person to financially support them.
Okay. So let's quickly talk about specifically, since you did raise it, as far as scams, and we know there's a variety of types of scams. They come via phone calls, you were mentioning the internet, mail even, you know, when they make the letter look very official from an official agency that is disconcerting. It might be Medicare looking, Social Security look alike, that kind of thing. So let's talk a little bit, a minute or two, about what's going on there and what we should be alerted to.
Right. I mean, oftentimes when we're involved with people who are being scammed, especially people who are being scammed to a large degree, you know, because the scammers typically start out small and build from there. But it's not uncommon that people's phones are ringing constantly. That this, you know, oftentimes when a worker is in the home, the scammer may call. They find out that someone else is there. They say, "I'll call back." 5 minutes later, the phone's ringing again. They often discourage people from speaking about what's going on, especially, you know, even if, well, you won this lottery or you're going to get this money, but you can't tell anybody because that might jeopardize us being able to help you, or you receiving your winnings. People often, especially if they've fallen victim to one scam, we often see people getting reams and reams and reams of mail that, you know, they fall victim and the information gets and they become
a
target.
Okay.
You know, we've had information where scammers are texting people. And these scammers are very skillful individuals. I recently had opportunity from one of our current cases to read a text exchange between an older adult and the scammer, and the scammer preyed on pretty much any human emotion you could think of. They professed their love for this individual. They used fear and intimidation.
They're very persistent.
You know,
keep going. I need this now.
Yes, and you know, they start with maybe a smaller amount and increase the amounts. We often see the scam evolve over time, where they start out, you've already won. We just need you to pay these taxes or these fees or what have you, and then it was a little bit short, or now we need to pay this, and they play that out for a while, and then we've seen them shift and claim to be law enforcement helping to get the person's money back. You know, and that's when they say, "Well, we're helping you. You can't get anybody else involved, or this is going to get messed up." You know, they really.
And then even if you think you want to tell somebody, whether you've gotten over that fear, now you fear looking stupid. You know, fear of that scam, and how am I going to tell somebody, and so on. And so they're building that in, scam.
You know, and they're going to take you out of your home. They're going to place you in a nursing home. They prey upon that fear as well. And, you know, unfortunately, you know, we encounter people who are highly functional in all areas of their life. You know, they're still going to their doctor's appointments. They're still able to take care of themselves, but they've gotten sucked in to the scam, and sometimes multiple scams, and just cannot be convinced, despite our staff telling them, you know, despite getting law enforcement involved and law enforcement telling them, you are being scammed.
Yeah.
You know, they unfortunately
the scammer did a great job,
right,
in convincing
right.
them that this is true. In like the 2 minutes that we have, so what can I do in terms of as the individual, you know, the individual who, whether it's been financial exploitation or feels emotionally abused or suspects that someone is taking from their bank account or what, any of those forms, as that individual, I can call and report that.
Yes.
And so can, let's say, the neighbor, the church, or mm-hmm. anybody else that suspects some of those things after talking and time and changes and whatnot. So let's put back, we want to show this slide one more time as far as please again. I can't stress that you don't have to be the investigator as the person who's calling. I'm going to have that mention that you can report elder abuse by contacting our agency, which is the Berks County Area Agency on Aging. The phone number there is 610-478-6500. We have regular office hours, but an on-call worker after 5. Or you can call the Pennsylvania Department of Aging Elder Abuse Hotline at 1-800-490-8505. And as we close, Tina, I would like you to, if I do, follow up. And I say, I'm going to call. I realize that this has happened, or this is, might be going on with my neighbor, and I'm not sure. And I reach out and make that call quickly in 1 minute. Can you just tell us, you know, how that call will be received?
Okay, you'll be connected with an intake worker or the on-call worker, depending upon the time of day. And they're going to ask you a broad scope of questions. Demographic information, name, date of birth, address, phone number, the types of allegations. There are a series of questions. Certainly the most important things are the name, the address, the telephone number, the age of the mm-hmm. individual, and what your concerns are. We will ask you other information if you know are familiar.
As best to your knowledge, you would
but
provide.
But to the
that.
Best of your knowledge, you know, we certainly understand that neighbors or banks or are not going to have all the information that we may be asking. But as much information as you're able to provide, the better.
And I can talk to a person in confidence.
Yes.
And
yes.
Know that my information will be kept within your organization.
Correct. It's helpful if we have the name and a phone number to call back the reporter mm-hmm. if the assigned worker has additional questions or we're having difficulty accessing that older adult or contacting them. But we certainly were forbidden by law from sharing that information with anyone. Does that mean that people oftentimes don't have an idea? You know, especially if the person's world is very small and they don't come into contact with a lot of people, oftentimes they make assumptions about who called us, but we never
sure.
confirm or deny
okay.
who the reporter is.
All righty. Well, really, that is about all the time that we have for today's show on elder abuse. Please, if you do have concerns of any type, please call the Berks County Area Agency on Aging and, you know, talk to an intake staff person, and they can help you decipher what that might be and to take that information down, and we'll be kept safe and confidential. Well, thank you so much, and thanks for tuning in.